up, YouTube? It's me, Bit, from BitBlogs, here with another episode. I just wanted to apologize to you guys about how long it's been since I've done a video. It's been crazy with how COVID-19's been acting. It's definitely kept me busy with work and everything, and I realized I never did a video for my top albums of 2020. I'm just gonna get into it. Here we go. Number 30 was Incubus' Trustfall, Side B. Wasn't so much as good as Side A. Thought it was great from front to back, but this new EP, it feels like they're trying too hard to do something that they've never really done before. It feels forced. Like, it doesn't feel like they actually made it because they wanted to make it. It feels like they put it together because they needed to put new material out there. Number 29 is Galantis' Church. Now, ever since they made their Pharmacy album, it feels like they've not really advanced their sound or, you know, tried things out with other types of electronic music. It feels like they really stuck to their roots. It doesn't feel like they really tried anything new. Number 28 is Carly Rae Jepsen's Dedicated Side B. Now, this album is basically an album of B-sides, but she released it as the follow-up to her last album, Dedicated. It's a good album. It's solid. Carly Rae Jepsen never fails to put out a good song. It didn't really flow as well as her Emotion album does. Number 27 is Selena Gomez's Rare. This album came out an interesting time. COVID hadn't really hit yet, so it was definitely an interesting time period. And then like a month later released a deluxe version of the album, but it's a great album overall. Selena Gomez is very talented vocally and it definitely shows. Number 26 is Real Estate's The Main Thing. Now, I thought it wasn't gonna be the greatest album when I first was introduced to it, but their first single, Paper Cup, that came out actually convinced me otherwise. It reminded me a lot of their earlier work with Days and Atlas, trying different things, but putting them in a way that would actually feel like a Real Estate record. Number 25 is Sam Smith's Left Goes. Sam Smith has never really been a musician that I've been a huge fan of, mostly because his slower stuff sounds very similar to one another. He tries something very different on this album, where he decides to go for a more pop route instead of like an adult contemporary kind of vibe. He's actually branching out and trying new things. Number 24 is Katy Perry's Smile. A lot of people really did not like this album. Personally, I actually really enjoyed it. It was just a lot of pressure of her trying to put out the next teenage dream. So that's where she kind of lost a lot of people on her last album, Witness, because she made it out to be this big, like, political album when it was nothing like a political album whatsoever. The tones are very goofy and playful, but the lyrics, you can tell that this came naturally to her. It wasn't so much a slow burner. So she let herself shine through. Number 23 is Tycho's Simulcast. This album is basically the instrumental version of their album Weather, but a lot of people were very against Saint Sinner being the singer on the actual album. What's nice about Simulcast is that it gives them that chance to take the songs, rework them into a standalone Tycho track, and they do a great job of that. Number 22 is Calm Truise's Indica 2. This is a sequel to Indica. With this album, it doesn't feel like the hype of the first album. Like, Indica was phenomenal. He drops this one and there's a lot of slow burners. There's some stuff back from Galactic Melt that wasn't released. It doesn't feel like anything new. Number 21 is Shawn Mendes' Wonder. Shawn Mendes, I never really started off as a big fan. I was more into Ed Sheeran than I was Shawn Mendes, but the way that he's made this transition to pop from singer-songwriter definitely shines through. You can tell that he's been struggling with everything, so this album was definitely a great chance for him to put his creative side forward and mesh as many genres as he could together. Number 20 is Bauer's Planets Mad. Bauer is quite the interesting electronic artist. He goes from industrial to chill wave to trap to electro house. He's just all over the electronic spectrum. It feels kind of like a mixed album almost, but it also makes the album great how each song transitions into the next one. It's got lots of bangers. It's got some slow burners, but it's also quite different from his first album. Number 19 is Phantom's Moonlight EP. I personally love Phantoms. After watching them grow and going on to Republic Records and Casablanca Records, it's been cool to see them rise in stardom. This EP, however, doesn't feel like any of their other stuff because it doesn't feel like there's a flow between each song. It feels like a collection of stuff that they've been working on this year rather than an actual solid piece of work. It just felt like they just put the tracks in an EP and said, here you go. Now, don't get me wrong, the music on the EP is great. However, I just don't like how it flows. Number 18 is The Strokes' The New Abnormal. So this one was a long time coming. Julian Casablancas hadn't released a new album with The Strokes since their Come Down Machine album, which came out back in 2013. I have to tell you, it was definitely worth the wait. It felt a lot like their older stuff. They have this signature sound that's just so garage rock meets alternative rock that it's their own signature sound. And when they start adding synthesizers to the mix, it definitely makes it interesting. Number 17 is Mac Miller's Circles. Now, this is a posthumous album for Mac Miller, as he passed away a few years ago, and his family worked with the original producer of the album so that they could get the full album released. This album is a companion album to his last album, Swimming. Circles is definitely the more softer Swimming. Similar tones, his vocals really bring everything to light, as well as the smoothness. Number 16 is Adam Lambert's Velvet. This one was definitely a slow build for me. When I first heard this album, I wasn't a huge fan of it. I thought his vocals were awesome because, I mean, let's be real, it's Adam Lambert. He definitely goes for a more 70s, 80s vibe with a modern twist. Everybody seems to be going back to the 80s for inspiration. It's very different and out there, but it feels perfect for him. Number 15 is Glass Animals' Dreamland. Now, before this album had been released, I'd never heard of Glass Animals. Well, I'd heard of them, but I'd never listened to anything that they'd ever released. I was like, huh, this album seems really interesting. I'm gonna check it out. And I don't regret it at all. It's like pop, alternative, fun is the way I describe it. It brings you from a whole journey of nostalgia into one. You know, there's references to Pokemon and Pepsi Blue and Digimon and basically all sorts of stuff that I grew up with. And the fact that they have their tapes from when they were kids as part of the album makes it even more interesting. Number 14 is The Killers' Imploding the Mirage. Definitely a different direction for The Killers. Their earlier stuff is a lot more pop punk with some indie alternative electronic kind of infused together. It was originally supposed to come out early in 2020 and got delayed because of COVID, but it wasn't because they felt like it wasn't the right timing. It was more or less because there was actual production delays because of how the virus was affecting them and their producers and everything on the album. It reminds me a lot of M83, a mixture between their last record, Wonderful Wonderful, and their Day and Age album. Number 13 is Gorillaz' Song Machine Season 1, Strange Times. I was actually surprised at Gorillaz for releasing this. I thought it was just gonna be they're gonna label it as, oh, it's a compilation of stuff we've been working on this year. But they're like, no, this is an album. This one actually surprised me because there's so many interesting collaborations on it. It's crazy how well it flows together. It's definitely out there, and I love that every single album that they do, there's something completely different about their sound and about what they do. It's such a good album. Number 12 is Washed Out's Purple Noon. Definitely feels like old school Washed Out, but he also works in new elements. He works with his wife a lot on the album, and it's such a vibey, like, chill wave album. Number 11 is Taylor Swift's Evermore. Now, Evermore is interesting because she had released Folklore earlier this year, just dropped it. She's like, you know what? New album coming out tomorrow. Everyone's like, what? Nobody was expecting what it would become. It's like a folk alternative album, but lots of storytelling. Well, she decided then, she's like, you know what? We never really stopped working on music, so here, have a second album. Everyone's like, what? It was unheard of for her to release two albums in the same year. I guess I'll talk about number 10, which is also her Folklore album. She released both of these within 4 to 6 months of each other, and it was really hard to decipher which one will be 11, which one will be number 10. Number 9 is Miley Cyrus's Plastic Hearts. This one was a complete shock to me. It's definitely got a vibe that runs from like the 70s to the 90s to like early 2000s, compiled into one album. There's such weird collaborations, but they're so good. Number 8 is Ariana Grande's Positions. Now this album is definitely no Thank You Next. That's still, honestly in my opinion, her best album to date. However, this one you could tell she was definitely bored during the pandemic, because there's just so many sexual overtones. But she's also at an age where she can make that kind of stuff. There's even a song, an entire song, where she literally sings an entire Mariah Carey-esque, like, high-pitched craziness. It's a really good album. Number 7 is Disclosure's Energy. This album is a lot more interesting because you've got so many different influences. You've got Afrobeats, French singers, so much going on in this album. It's like a melting pot of different nationalities and different walks of life, which also makes it very cool how they did everything. Number 6 is Neon Trees, I Can Feel You Forgetting Me. This one's really interesting because it's such a relatable, incredible album with such emotional tones, but you see this arc of missing someone to getting over that person, and it's such a transformation. It's really good, it's phenomenal. Number 5 is AC/DC's Power Up. Now, after they released their Rock or Bust album, I thought they were done. They had Malcolm Young, who had passed away, and the lead singer, Brian Johnson, was losing his hearing. They were already in the works, and this is stuff left over from when they made Black Ice that they threw together as a memento to Malcolm. What's great about this album is it literally feels like when I first listened to AC/DC, how I sat down and put on Back in Black. They kept their signature sound. It felt like they never lost their touch. Number 4 is The Weeknd's After Hours. I will say this is definitely his best album to date. There's not a single feature on the album. It's all him. And it literally makes you feel like you're transported into the 80s. But this album is just, that's all I can say about it. It's just, it's so good. Number 3 is Dua Lipa's Future Nostalgia. It was very hard for me to debate between number 3 and number 1 for Future Nostalgia. She literally encompasses everything musically that she grew up with. Pop, 80s pop, there's disco, there's a little bit of house, there's different moving pieces to this album that literally feels like a giant nostalgia trip, and you feel transported back to a discotheque back in the 80s. Every single song is perfect on the album. Number 2 is Tame Impala's The Slow Rush. Kevin Parker of Tame Impala, it seems like a big thing that stuck with him is time and the passing of time, how you lose things, how things pass by you, how opportunities are missed. When he produced this album, you could tell that it's straight up classic Tame Impala. I would say it's just as good as Currents. Every song flows right into one another in such a cool way that only Kevin Parker can do. Number 1 is Lady Gaga's Chromatica. The album is just so good from beginning to end, and everything flows so perfectly. Even the bonus tracks that she released for the album are perfect. A lot of people will very strongly disagree with me on this, but I think this is better than Art Pop. Art Pop is still a phenomenal album, and it's honestly, in my opinion, her second best. But you can tell that she put so much into this to make it right, to make it perfect, to make it her, and to just create this whole world of Chromatica. It really sets this album apart from all of the rest of her material. There you have it. That was my top 30 of 2020. Thank you guys so much for watching. If you enjoyed, feel free to comment and subscribe below. And yeah, thanks for tuning in. Bye guys.